Hello everyone, in this lecture I am going to discuss about normal puerperium. So as we know that there are variety of changes that took place during pregnancy, and in concern of bodily changes like metabolic changes or the hematological changes, there are many more. So these all changes that the anatomical and the physiological changes that took place in the woman's body tissue, these all revert back to their pre-pregnant state. That is called the puerperal period, and this appear following the delivery. Okay, so following the delivery, this all going to be revert back in the previous state, and it takes 6 weeks of duration. Yes, so it lasts for about 6 weeks on an average, and sometimes this period is also referred as fourth trimester because there are some changes that takes 8 to 12 weeks to complete this whole process. So the woman who is in this period is called as puerpera. Yes, and there is one more term which is called involution. So in this involution, the genital tract organs are only reverting back to their pre-pregnant state. So in this lecture, we'll discuss what all genital organs are there which revert back to pre-pregnant state. Okay, so first we talk about the uterus. After the delivery, the uterus is returning back and it is measuring about 20 into 12 into 7.5 centimeter cube. That is the length, breadth and thickness. And it is weighing about 1000 gram after the delivery. But at the end of first week, it is of being 500 gram. And by the end of fourth week, it became 100 gram. Okay, so you can say that around fourth week, it is just near about the pre-pregnant state, because in pre-pregnant state, the weight of the uterus is about 60 gram. Yes, now in the uterus, the portion which forms the lower segment is the isthmus. Yes, so following delivery, the isthmus become thin, flabby and collapsed structure, and it takes few weeks to revert back to their original structure. Okay, then comes the cervix. It contract very slowly. Okay, so once the delivery took place, we can admit 2 fingers in the cervix. Yes, but by the first week, we can just admit the tip of finger. Yes, the counter and the tone of the cervix, the endocervical canal, just returning back, but it is not in same manner as in nulli paras state, because it is the birth canal through which the fetus is passing. Yes, so in the cervix, if we compare the nulli paras cervix, it is pinpointing, but in multiparous women, it is slightly in form of transverse slit. Okay, because this is the structure through which the fetus is passing. Yes, so it remains slightly dilated. Okay, if we assess clinically the involution of the uterus, how much the uterus is contracting, because the contraction and retraction is the continuous phenomena following delivery also. So the height of the uterus is continuously reducing. Okay, so once the fetus comes out, as the delivery took place, the height remained just below the umbilicus. So if we measure the symphysis fundal height, that is the height from the pubic symphysis till the highest point of the uterus, fundus region, will measure that the height is about 13.5 centimeter, or you can say 5.5 inch. Okay, so but it remained constant for about 24 hours. Okay, and after 24 hours, it is reducing continuously, and what is the rate? It is reducing about 1.25 centimeter in each day. Okay, so by the end of second week, the uterus became pelvic organ because it lies in the pelvic cavity. Okay, because the height is continuously reducing, the uterus is continuously shrinking. Yes, so by this measurement, we can assess that the uterus is involuting or not at correct pace. And if we assess the vagina, in vagina also, as it forms the birth canal through which the fetus must pass, so it remained dilated because it is most distensible structure through which the fetus is passing. So yes, the tone as well as the rugae, that is the folds in the wall of this vagina, reappears after third week following the delivery, but it is not up to the mark as same in nulliparous state. Okay, yes, they are returning, but not in full-fledged manner. Okay, so it is also remain slightly dilated, the introitus remain dilated slightly. So in the uterus, the changes are going to be take place in the muscle fibers, the endometrium, in the blood vessels, right? Because there is a continuous hypertrophy and hyperplasia in the muscle fiber of the uterus during the pregnancy. So when the height of the uterus is reducing, it doesn't mean that the number of cells is reducing. Okay, that does not reduce. The only size of muscle fiber is reducing. Okay, and we know that with this delivery process, the decidua, the endometrial lining, is removing. Yes, so there is a regeneration of this endometrial lining, and from where it begins, it starts from decidua basalis, because we know that the decidua is formed from the functional layer. Yes, that is usually removed, but the new growth and the new layer usually forms by the basal layer of the endometrium. So this stratum basalis, that is the decidua basalis, give rise to this new endometrial lining. Okay, so this endometrial, that is the decidua basalis, regenerate itself, and the regeneration process begins on 7th day. Okay, and by the day of 16th, the regeneration of endometrial lining completes. Okay, it generally complete its endothelial lining. Okay, but the placental site does not fully reforms. Okay, because once the uterus contract and it reduces its size following delivery, the placental site become the size of palm only. Okay, but it takes 6 weeks. How much it is taking? It takes 6 weeks to completely reform. Okay, so yes, the regeneration of endometrial lining begins on 7th day, and the entire endometrium is reformed till by the 16th day, but at the placental site it takes 6 weeks to complete its reformation, because this is the major site from where the placenta get separated. Yes, and along with that, there are the contraction of blood vessels, and they get thrombosed, and they underwent in hyaline regeneration. Yes, and from there the new vessels are grown up. Okay, so when the regeneration of new endometrial lining is going on, there is a shedding of decidual lining, that is necros cell, which is mixed with the RBCs, WBCs, or some shreds of fetal membrane, and this all mixture which comes out through this decidual basalis, that is from the uterine body, which comes out through the vaginal route, that is the vaginal discharge, is called as lochia. Okay, so the lochia is a vaginal discharge. So this admixture of all things which comes out through the vaginal route, that is this vaginal discharge, is usually last for about 2 weeks, that is for the first fortnight, 14 days or the 2 weeks. So depending on its the characteristics, that is the color, it again divided into three, that is the lochia rubra, as it is red in color, and it releases on first 4 days. Okay, and this lochia rubra mainly contains RBCs, decidual sheds that become necrosed, and shreds of fetal membrane, and the vernix casusa, lanugo, meconium, this all mixed together and releases during first 4 days. That is called the lochia rubra, because mainly it is contributing of RBC, and because of that it is in red color. Then after that, when the WBC counts are more, when it is mixed with the mucus, WBC and some microorganism, then it is to be called as lochia serosa, and it is in yellowish or pink in color, and it releases after 4 days, that is from 5 to 9 days, and because it is slightly serous in nature, and after the 9th day the secretion is to be called as lochia alba because it is white in color. So it releases from day 10 to 15, and this is mainly contributing of microorganism, and it is more in WBCs. Okay, and there are mucus from the cervix as well. So depending on its color, the lochia is to be termed as rubra, serosa and the alba. But we need to know clinically that this local discharge is correct or not, because during first week, or you can say that during first 5 to 6 days, the loss is estimated to be 250 ml. Okay, there may be a 250 ml of blood loss during first 5 to 6 or 1 week duration. And if we talk about its property, it is initially alkaline in property, and it is slightly fishy in smell, and the duration may extend up to the 3 weeks. Okay, so if there is any variation in the color or in the duration or in order, we can identify any pathology behind this, because if the amount is scanty, then we can rule out there may be a collection of this blood in the uterine cavity, and that may be called as lochiometra. Or if the lochia rubra, the duration of bleeding is more than 4 days or more than that, then we can rule out there may be a bits of cotyledon which remain inside the uterine cavity. So that's why the bleeding is more. Okay, and if the bad odor is there, foul odor is there, mal odor is there, then it can be ruled out that there may be any infection. And the lochia alba secretion is extending more than this period, then we can rule out any other genital lesions or infection is there. So we need to assess this all clinical parameter for rule out this involution. So here we have seen what is involution and what all changes that brings about in this involution, where the genital organs are reverting back to their pre-pregnant state, and what all physiological alteration we can see in the uterine cavity. Thank you.